Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Careers for Dummies by Marty Nemko, narrated by Stephen Bowlby. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. The publisher and the author make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation, warranties of fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales or promotional materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for every situation. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, or other professional services. If professional assistance is required, the services of a competent professional person should be sought. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. The fact that an organization or website is referred to in this work as a citation and/or a potential source of further information does not mean that the author or the publisher endorses the information the organization or website may provide or recommendations it may make. Further, readers should be aware that internet websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Foreword. A new career book. Do we really need another career book? A quick Amazon search of books related to careers brings up 100,000 titles. Job hunting books, 40,000 titles. The category of career books is crowded with superficial, repetitive, and uninspiring advice, often from individuals whose only expertise seems to be that they themselves were once hired by someone. Or those who think they have the latest out-of-the-box wild idea like, don't write a resume. And then, I was given the opportunity to read Marty Nemko's latest book, Careers for Dummies. I read it cover to cover because, despite managing career centers at Dickinson College, the University of Texas at Austin, Wake Forest University, and Vanderbilt University, I know there's always something new to learn, particularly where Marty Nemko is involved. I first encountered Marty's work in 1998 when he published Cool Careers for Dummies. I had been working in the field of career services for over 10 years at that point, specializing in helping liberal arts students articulate the value of their education to potential employers. Most career books at that time were written with the assumption that the job seeker had a traditional degree, business or engineering, and sought a job in those fields, not cool careers. It opened up a world of ideas for my liberal arts students. They didn't have to become bankers, lawyers, or professors. There were plenty of other cool careers, interesting careers, that would benefit from their knowledge and skills. Over the years, I've purchased copies for all my career coaching staffs so they could use it in their work with students. I personally met Marty in 2009 when the first edition of my book, You Majored in What?, was published. Marty asked me to appear as a call-in guest on his radio show, a San Francisco-based national public radio program, Work with Marty Nemko. We had an engaging conversation around chaos theory as it relates to careers of liberal arts students, and it was a pleasure to meet the author behind one of my favorite career books. So, what does Marty's latest career book have to offer? Aside from being well-organized and packed with new ideas and information, this is a book which clears through the clutter. It harnesses the best of the ever-expanding information about career exploration and development. It will help you organize every aspect of your career, from uncovering your strengths to succeeding on the job. It is truly a soup-to-nuts guide to the career search and the career development process. Career seekers have to consider three main questions: who am I? Where can I work? And how do I get there? Many career books focus on the first and third questions, and Careers for Dummies is no exception. Those topics are covered thoroughly. But when it comes to the second question, there is a dearth of good information about what's out there. It's a tough topic to handle because it's at once vast and yet highly specific. Career counselors are often stuck using the less than scintillating Dictionary of Occupational Titles, or the Occupational Outlook Handbook. This is where Careers for Dummies shines. In Part 2, the Careers Catalog, you will be introduced to over 300 interesting and intriguing careers. Two chapters in particular caught my attention. Chapter 6, STEM Careers, Science, Technology, Engineering, Math, and Chapter 7, STEM plus People or Word Careers. Few career books tackle these important areas of employment, and myths abound about these fields, including the myth that STEM jobs are readily available. After all, aren't we always hearing about the lack of people to fill STEM positions? Doesn't Yahoo regularly let us know that the highest paid jobs are in STEM fields? The truth is, these jobs are highly specialized, often require advanced degrees, and do not fit neatly into one package despite the appealing acronym of STEM. Jobs for a bachelor's level biology major are quite different from jobs for a PhD in physics or a master's degree in math. These two chapters illuminate the variety of careers for individuals with differing STEM backgrounds, describing the typical careers in each field, and then adding what Marty calls neat niches, interesting lesser-known specialties that might be worth investigating. Careers like cancer registrar, packaging engineer, or virtual reality programmer might not be on Yahoo's top career list, but probably should be. And this section doesn't just list job opportunities, it delves into the mindsets STEM majors will need to develop to succeed, including an interdisciplinary mindset and high emotional intelligence. Finally, Careers for Dummies goes beyond most career books in that it also provides information for succeeding in the workplace once you have the position. This book could quite possibly be the only career book you will need to complete your job search. Except for mine, of course. Buy them both. A new career book. Do we really need another one? If it's Careers for Dummies by Marty Nemko, we do. Dr. Catherine S. Brooks, Evans Family Executive Director, Vanderbilt University Career Center, Nashville, Tennessee. Introduction. In our demanding, fast-paced world, it's challenging to pick a career, land a good job, and succeed in it. This book can help. About this book. I hope you'll consider this book your virtual career coach, your little black career book. It shares much of what I've learned from having worked with over 5,000 clients. Here's a walkthrough. I start by helping you look at the big trends in part one, finding your place in the work world. That can help you sail with, instead of against, the wind. It might even help you get in on the ground floor of the next big thing. In choosing a career, it helps to find out what makes you special. So, one chapter helps you do that. Another way to find your specially suited career is to look under the radar. This book's DIY Under the Radar Career Finder can help you find niches that fit you. After you've gotten to know more about yourself, you can browse Part 2, the Careers Catalog. It offers a brief scoop on 340 careers, the popular ones, plus plenty of under-the-radar options. Each scoop ends with a link to more information. The careers are arranged in categories to make it easier to home in on well-suited choices. In another chapter, I offer my favorite low-risk self-employment ideas, plus a tool to help you decide whether you're likely to be successfully self-employed. Then I turn to describing how to try on a career. Like a suit of clothes, a career may look good on the rack, but when you try it on, you may love it or cringe. And like a suit, for a career to really work, it may need to be tailored and accessorized. I'll show you how. It's all well and good to pick a well-matched career, but you need to be well-trained to avoid the imposter syndrome, when you feel less competent than your diploma suggests you are. Sometimes, that means choosing the right major and college or graduate school program. But at other times, it's wise to do some, or even all, your career preparation outside the halls of academe. Either way, this book has you covered, even down to how to convince an employer that you're worth hiring because you attended UU instead of State U. Of course, career training is important, but we all know people who are well-trained yet don't live up to their potential. They may have issues that keep them from being, as the Army commercial said, all that you can be. Perhaps they're wrapped up in self-doubt and fear, or they're inveterate procrastinators. So, read the chapter, Getting Emotionally Solid. Next, it's time to land a job, a good one. The next few chapters show you how to do more than just answer ads, how to get referred in, for example. And to summarize those chapters, I list, day by day, what I would actually do to get the essence of my job search done in a week. Yes, a week. Okay, so after you have a job offer, do you just take it or do you negotiate? And if you negotiate, how can you do it without the offer getting pulled or you're getting stressed out? Well, not too stressed out. That's the topic of the chapter, Negotiating Wisely. Now you're on the job. How can you get good at it and maybe even become beloved? I'll talk about the unspoken rules of the workplace, managing your boss, time, stress, and supervisees, cultivating charisma, and even public speaking without fear. But what if, despite all efforts, you've picked the wrong career or simply decided that you've been there, done that, and it's time for something new? The next chapter shows four approaches to changing careers. Then I get philosophical. What really matters to you? This chapter can help you decide on your work life's foundational principles. Then I step back and offer a pessimistic view of the future, an optimistic one, and my prediction. To end on a lighter note, the book concludes with The Part of Tens, 10 ultra-fast ways to land a job, 10 career myths, and, as an opportunity for me to sound like your father, 10 plus 5 preachy please. Icons used in this book. For Dummies books highlight particularly important text with these icons. Tip. This book is filled with tips, but I mark particularly important or fresh ones with tip. Remember, you may have heard these ideas before, but they're important enough to deserve a shout-out. Warning. Avoid these common pitfalls and you probably won't bomb out. Beyond the book. In addition to the material in the book or ebook you're now reading, you get a free Access Anywhere cheat sheet with even more tips for landing that dream job. To get this cheat sheet, visit dummies.com and type Careers for Dummies cheat sheet in the search box. After reading this book, if you still have questions, email me at mnemko@comcast.net. I promise to answer you. Marty Nemko. Where to go from here? You may choose to read this book from cover to cover, or you may prefer to read just what you need when you need it. That's just in time learning. I hope you find this book worthwhile and enjoyable. Part 1. Finding Your Place in the Work World. In this part, how the world is changing. Figure out where you fit. Find under-the-radar niches. Chapter 1. Understanding Today's and Tomorrow's World of Work. In this chapter, seeing what will likely endure, seeing what will likely change, the saga of a career. This chapter can help you find your place in the world of work, both today and tomorrow. More specifically, it looks at what's likely to remain the same and what's likely to change over the decades of your work life. Although I'm not in possession of a crystal ball, I do have some insights into what you can expect to come down the pike over the course of the next 10, 20, 30, or even 40 years. This chapter spells out some of those insights. Timeless truths. It's been said that the only person who likes change is a wet baby. So let me start by describing what's likely to remain relatively constant over your work span. What employers seek in an employee. Employees with the attributes described in the following list will continue to have good job prospects. Tech plus. Ever more jobs will create both soft and technical skills. Some jobs will continue to require mainly what are referred to as soft skills, effective communication, organization, attention to detail, for example. But ever more jobs will also require skills that are far more technically oriented. It could be simply knowing how to use the field's major software, or it could be having in-depth knowledge of supply chain management or machine learning design. Reasoning skills. Most well-paying jobs require employees to make many decisions each day that require good thinking skills, including the not-so-common common sense. Emotional solidity. A person can be smart and knowledgeable, yet be unsuccessful. Success requires resilience to life's slings and arrows. You may be able to develop and strengthen that capability to an unexpected degree, as you can see in Chapter 13. Large organizations are desirable employers. Startups make for lots of sexy-sounding headlines because of a ping-pong and Red Bull culture, and when a startup goes public, it makes its founders zillionaires. Beyond the headlines, startups have other pluses. They often allow you to wear many hats in the service of a cutting-edge product and offer the prospect of a big-buck exit. Just remember that most startups quickly go bust, leaving employees jobless and with stock options worth zippo. Sure, working for a large company has some disadvantages. Your role may be narrow, and you may be forced to follow procedure and the chain of command. But a solid structure can help a company be greater than the sum of its parts. Combine that concept with the deep pockets, refined processes, and good products associated with larger companies, and it's easy to understand why many graduates of prestigious colleges continue to want to work for category killers like Apple, Google, Citibank, Johnson & Johnson, Goldman Sachs, 3M, General Electric, and Procter & Gamble. Similarly, people who prefer nonprofits are attracted to major players like UNICEF, Planned Parenthood, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And people who prize job security and a pro-social mission gravitate to the largest employer, the government. The importance of choosing a career wisely. Finding a career that matches your abilities, interests, and values will remain important, and not just because your success and happiness matter. If you've picked correctly, and thus stayed in your career for at least a few years, you'll have had the time to acquire the in-depth knowledge that many careers require. Rigorous hiring practices. Today's job seekers are likely aware that candidates applying for good jobs are often invited to apply. They're referred in by colleagues, or recruiters find them by trolling professional forums and speakers lists from professional conferences. For a database of professional associations, check out directoryofassociations.com. So, participate in your profession's community. That makes you more employable and competent and, in turn, feeling better about the work you do. In recent years, job seekers have come to expect multiple rounds of interviews and tests of their technical skills, from typing to coding. That will continue. It means the job seekers will continue to need to show, not just tell. For example, today's winning resume should usually include a professional development section that lists key learning outcomes from career-specific trainings, from an in-person workshop to an online certificate. Remember, the good news is that hiring practices involving multiple interviews help ensure that merit, and not other factors, drive hiring decisions. That benefits not only good candidates, but also coworkers and customers. Homework. More and more people are working from home. Because of the ever-growing traffic in many cities, more employees are asking to telecommute or work from home, at least for part of the work week. Many employers support telecommuting because it saves the expense of providing office space. In addition, cheap, reliable video conferencing makes video meetings more acceptable than in the past. Gigification. Many employees will continue to be needed full-time, 52 weeks a year. but employers will continue to replace other employees with gig employees or just-in-time employees who are contracted to complete specific projects. Employers are sometimes tempted to replace full-time employees with these giggers because it's ever more expensive to hire U.S. workers. That expense includes not just salaries, but also government-mandated benefits and protections, increased Social Security and workers' compensation limits, employee lawsuits, and employer-paid health care, for example. Remember, some people lament America's gigification. They prefer stability over having to look for new work every few months. They prefer working with the same people for a long time. It can feel good to experience life's key times together. On the other hand, some people like the gig economy's flexibility. They benefit from the novelty of the experience, the option of taking breaks to complete that dream project or travel destination, or perhaps even a chance at a fresh start after a financial meltdown, for example. What will likely change? During your work span, the world is sure to change dramatically. The following sections take a look at what changes will most likely affect your world of work. Yes, the robots are coming, but not so fast. Sure, more jobs are becoming automated, but the worry that robots will entirely take over the workforce may be overblown. Yes, though repetitive work will likely be automated, for at least the next decade, most jobs requiring judgment will be augmented by, but not replaced by, technology. For example, physicians will have a sort of a Dr. Watson to aid in diagnosing patients and choosing a treatment, though we're a long way from having to hear the online receptionist say, "The robot will see you now." Truth of the matter is that every time a new technology has been developed, from the steam engine to the search engine, it was predicted that the technology would kill jobs. More jobs were created, however, including many that couldn't even have been imagined. Plus, in selecting the 340 careers to include in part two of this book, I've considered the risk of a career being automated. There should be ample options, both technological and not, that would capitalize on technological advances. Here are a few examples. The fashionable future. It shouldn't be long before you can visit a clothing website, pick a fabric and style, and enter your body measurements, and then print the perfectly customized item at home on your 3D printer. Yes, the system will eliminate repetitive clothing manufacturing jobs, but those are low-paying and not fun anyway. The replacement jobs will inevitably be more interesting. For example, people will likely buy more clothes, given how easy and, eventually, inexpensive it will be to purchase what they're in the mood for. That will create jobs for everything from fabric designer to image consultant, and from fabric ink manufacturer to repairer of those printers eternally cranking away in 3D. Future data farmers of America. In this increasingly ever more data-centric world, people will be hired to collect and interpret the information that companies, nonprofits, and government are acquiring. Consider merely how much data Google and Facebook alone already have on each of its users. Artificial intelligence will enable ever more personalized ads to be presented. It will even infer your moods and send you just-in-time ads. That will increase the number of jobs that are available, for example, as data scientist, market researcher, marketing manager, social media marketing specialist, nonprofit fundraiser, and donor database manager. The future of love. Even advances in dating will create jobs. Dating already has evolved from the old-fashioned matchmaker to Match.com and a bevy of similar dating sites, from Tinder to JDate. New jobs will likely be created because of next-generation dating sites. An algorithm will infer your essence from your social media posts and then suggest good fits. Swipe right, and you'll see a 3D holographic video of the person introducing himself, or herself. I rotate the terms in this book. Swipe left, and you'll teach the algorithm to improve its predictions. Jobs will be created not just for designers of dating sites, but also for coaches, for example, to guide your journey to your prince or princess. Acme robots. And of course, the more robots that are coming, the more people will be hired to design, build, install, maintain, and repair them. I wouldn't worry too much about the robots. Hey, they've been trying to sell us robotic vacuum cleaners for almost 20 years now, and most of us are still pushing around our Hoovers. Education, reinvented. Campus-based higher education is under increasing scrutiny. In addition to the daunting cost, many people complain that courses are too theoretical or too biased or too saddled with content of little interest to too many students. Those critics cite the Academically Adrift study, which found that more than one-third of college students grew little to not at all between their freshman and senior years in education's core outcomes, analytic reasoning, critical thinking, and writing. Other criticisms include a residence hall culture that too often is, let's just say, not conducive to studying. And of course, with ever more students graduating, the bachelor's degree no longer confers a large advantage in the job market. A Northeastern University analysis of federal data found that more than half of college graduates under age 25 are unemployed or doing jobs that require no more than a high school education. And that result assumes that they've graduated. Only 59% do, even if given 6 years to complete their studies. There has been a move to online education. Thousands of undergraduate and graduate courses are available via just two sites, Coursera.org and edX.org. Alas, because many of those courses are similar to the in-person version but without the in-person interaction, the average completion rate is low. But moving forward, colleges are attempting to compete with short and full-length courses offered by generally more practical providers such as Lynda, lynda.com, Udemy, udemy.com, and Udacity, udacity.com. That competition should result in larger numbers of shorter courses based on interactive videos and led by transformational instructors, including luminary practitioners. For example, Masterclass, masterclass.com, offers online courses in filmmaking by Martin Scorsese, writing by Judy Blum and James Patterson, comedy by Steve Martin, fashion by Diane von Furstenberg, architecture by Frank Gehry, singing by Christina Aguilera, jazz by Herbie Hancock, drama by David Mamet, tennis by Serena Williams, and environmental science by Jane Goodall. And each costs just $90. Harvard, let alone no-name college, needs to respond, lest traditional higher education venues become dinosaurs. Kindergarten through 12th grade, or K-12, education will progress more slowly toward online education because of its custodial function, the perceived need for a primarily high-touch rather than high-tech education, and the heavy unionization and need to protect teachers' jobs. But the United States has largely abandoned ability-grouped classes, especially in grades K through 8. Instead, a class today may include special needs students, gifted students, native speakers of English, and newcomers from many countries. Those diverse needs can be addressed only by technology, using individualized, self-paced instruction taught in multiple languages. Of course, because such classes could be taught primarily on video, the most effective teachers could teach them, enabling rich and poor, from Beverly Hills to Harlem, to obtain a world-class education. The live teacher, or at least a paraprofessional, would still be needed, for example, for classroom discipline, getting kids unstuck, providing emotional support, and presiding over socialization activities. Of course, this situation has career implications. Would-be teachers or course developers might want to learn the art and science of creating and delivering transformational online courses. Regardless, it would likely be a decade or three until most high school courses, let alone lower grade levels, are delivered online by these super teachers. So jobs for teachers, especially in science, math, bilingual education and special education will likely remain viable. Tip: whatever your career, in your own education, career preparation, and personal learning, consider the full range of options on campus and online. For more on the topic of degree training, see chapters 11 and 12. Changing healthcare. Baby boomers aging, as well as other factors, will result in downscaling medical care. Increasingly, the doctor won't see you now. The physician's assistant will. The physical therapist won't help you return to your athletic self. The physical therapy assistant will. These intermediate healthcare providers, sometimes called allied health professionals, should find the job market felicitous. Cost pressures will also incentivize pharmaceutical and imaging companies to develop more cost-effective diagnostic tests and treatments for patients with acute physical conditions, mental disorders, and chronic disease, driving the need for these companies to bring in more medical researchers. Cost control pressures will also boost the need for self-monitoring wearable devices. It won't be long until the concept of today's insulin pump, which continually dispenses the proper amount to the diabetic patient, will be used more widely. Imagine, for example, that instead of your taking a daily fixed amount of birth control medication, your wearable would dispense more of it only when you need it. I can envision a day in which healthcare will center around the mobile phone. One end of a wire will plug into the phone, and the other to a sensor you tape to your skin, perhaps under your shirt or blouse. The sensor would read your health status, automatically dispense any drugs you need, and, as appropriate, contact your healthcare provider. Becoming a parent also may well change. Prospective parents have long been able to use in vitro fertilization, IVF, to get pregnant and to choose the baby's sex. In the future, embryo selection and repair may enable prospective parents to help ensure that the child is born without serious disease, and, if society deems it acceptable, to have genes predisposing to altruism and high intelligence. That would boost the demand for reproductive choice services. Of course, all this bodes well for medical researchers, especially those with expertise in the math and physics that undergird people's understanding of medical diagnosis and treatment. But such initiatives also require a wide range of employees, from test tube washers to technicians, and from clinical trials coordinators to grant writers. Going nuclear. There will likely also be a nuclear energy boon, I said. Boon, not boom. Pressure will probably continue for people to reduce their carbon footprints and for society to replace oil and natural gas with renewables, such as solar and wind. But renewables' physics delimitations should lead to major growth in the use of nuclear energy. It offers an unlimited source of energy with no carbon emissions. The nuclear industry's growth will accelerate as memories of Fukushima, Chernobyl, and Three Mile Island fade and safer technology becomes available. Bill Gates' company, Terra Power, is focusing on that goal. More east-west. Some Asian countries, notably China and India, have a long tradition of valuing science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM. Combine that with their large populations, low salaries, and increasing focus on innovation rather than on simple replication, and Asia will provide ever more formidable competition to U.S. companies and workers. So, subject to political constraints, U.S. businesses and governmental entities will likely increase mutually beneficial collaborations with the East. It will widely be decided that it's wiser to join them than to simply try to beat them. Tip: to leverage the trend of mutual collaboration with the East, learn how to facilitate such partnerships and joint ventures, whether you're an accountant who understands international rules, a scientist who's bilingual in Mandarin, or an entrepreneur who understands the variations in countries' sales techniques and ethical norms. Terrorism 2.0. Small-scale terrorism, such as slamming cars into pedestrians and machine-gunning shoppers, will likely lose impact, causing too much bad PR for any perceived increase in power. So terrorists may turn to weapons of mass destruction. Both groups will find it easier to do so, as the cost of developing communicable bioviruses and suitcase nukes declines. More spiritualism, less religion. The Pew Center for the Study of Religion reports that the fastest growing religion is no religion. But many people will undoubtedly continue to seek inspiration and comfort beyond day-to-day life. Hence, many people have replaced religiosity with non-deistic spirituality. For example, Buddhism and offshoots such as yoga and meditation. This should result in continued growth in spiritual teachers and leaders of spiritual communities and, yes, yoga instructors. Taylor's Tale. This story synthesizes common travails in choosing a career. Can you relate? Taylor was both excited and scared to go to college. Though she was looking forward to the freedom and adventure, she worried whether college would be difficult and whether she would make friends or miss living at home. She wasn't sure what to major in, so she applied to colleges undeclared. Taylor got admitted to more colleges than she had anticipated, but fearing that her family might take on too much student loan debt, she opted for an in-state public college. In Taylor's first semester, her favorite course was Introduction to Political Science, taught by a charismatic professor, and she earned an A. Amid the nation's political roiling, her interest in poli-sci grew, so she declared it as her major. But some of her subsequent poli-sci courses felt dry, so she switched to psychology. Taylor had personal issues and hoped that the major in psychology would help her understand herself, maybe even improve her state of mind, and be more career relevant. She did enjoy that major. Taylor mused about possible careers: psychotherapist, social worker, teacher, management trainee. She even wondered whether she should change majors again and go into healthcare, but decided that she didn't want to spend more years as an undergraduate. So she went to the campus career center to explore her options. The counselor there gave her the strong interest inventory and Myers-Briggs type indicator, and suggested that Taylor explore the career library using People Careers as a filter. Taylor scanned its books, videos, and databases, but left feeling that nothing popped out at her as a clear winning choice. So Taylor decided to defer selecting a career, hoping that something would soon emerge. Taylor graduated in 5 years, which is about normal for most students these days, and she and her family were proud. After the graduation ceremony, her family took her out for dinner, but when she was asked the time-honored question, "What are you going to do for a career?" Taylor could only say, "I'm exploring." She decided that travel might help her clarify, so she spent a month touring Europe. When she returned, however, she hadn't gained much clarity. Her parents worried that she'd become the stereotype: lots of student debt, but no job, and living with parents again to try to figure it out. Concerned, Taylor's dad asked whether she might like a job at the nonprofit where he served as human resources manager. Because she was afraid of falling behind her peers, and because she wanted money so that she could move out of her parents' house, she took the job, even though it was only part-time as a volunteer coordinator. Even though Taylor had an in and did well at the job, she wasn't offered a full-time benefited position. She wondered whether she should return to school for a master's degree in psychology or look for a job in the for-profit sector. She decided on the latter because she didn't feel prepared to complete more schooling. She took a job as a receptionist at a high-tech firm in Silicon Valley. One of her friends said, "You spent all that time and money on college, and you're going to be a receptionist?" Though that comment gave Taylor pause, another friend told her that being a receptionist for a good company can be a launch pad to a better job, so she took it. And that turned out to be true. She got to know personally many of the company's employees, and one helped her gain a position as a marketing management trainee. But soon she said to herself, "I'm not sure I want to spend my life marketing computer chips." And although she was aware of the standard advice not to leave a job until you have a better one, she quit. Taylor wondered what she should do next, so she journaled, and she asked friends and family. As time went by and she started missing college, she decided to look for job openings at her alma mater and got one in marketing for its alumni association. And she liked it. Sort of. First, it was just another part-time temporary gig. Then, floating in her brain was a question that she couldn't push out of her mind. Is that all there is? This book can help ensure that your story is better. Chapter 2. Finding What Makes You Special. In this chapter, unearthing your abilities, skills, interests, values, and preferences. The DIY Under the Radar Career Finder. Sometimes, you just want to feel like you fit in. But especially in choosing a career, you may want to find the answers to such questions as, is there anything special about me? What work would people pay me well for? Do I have a calling? In short, you're simply asking, who am I anyway? This chapter should help you figure it out. Who am I anyway? The following sections can help you identify your core abilities, skills, interests, values, and preferences. Your abilities. One way to unearth your core abilities is by completing the following steps to mine your accomplishments. Follow these steps. 1. List your accomplishments, big and small, starting with the earliest. Yes, this step can even include reattaching the wheel to your little red wagon, or teaching yourself to read, or consoling a fellow kindergartner who was crying. Continue forward to the present, that A grade you earned on a term paper, for example, or that Instagram story you posted that attracted lots of views, your election as club president, that app you developed, the road trip you organized, or the gadget you designed. 2. Next to each accomplishment, write the key embedded ability or two that made the accomplishment possible. Quick learning, fixing broken items hands-on, or catching errors in a sheaf of data, for example. 3. Put a star next to those abilities you'd enjoy using in your career. And voila, you've identified the key building blocks in choosing your career. Your skills. From infancy, people are continually acquiring skills. More recently, you may have learned how to run a meeting, perform CPR, or query databases with Hadoop. In this section, I'll help you identify one or more skills you want to use in your career. It's okay if you haven't yet acquired a particular skill. If you have the propensity and the desire, you may be able to sufficiently develop the skill. For example, many people who were afraid of speaking in public have become good at it. I offer a step-by-step plan for developing public speaking skills in Chapter 20. Remember, just because you're skilled at a task doesn't necessarily mean that you want to use the skill in your career. For example, you may be good at selling but not want a sales career. No problem. Leave that one off your list. You should include only skills that you might like to use in your career. Skills tend to fall in one of five categories. Interpersonal. You might, for example, be good at motivating people or at healing, persuading, calming, or teaching them, or being on a team with them. Even if you consider yourself a people person, you're unlikely to be strong in all those areas. So, which interpersonal skills are your strengths? List your last, say, half dozen successful interactions with people. Do you see common threads? Word. Some people are good at writing, reading complicated material, speaking one-on-one or speaking to groups, and a fortunate few are good at all of the above. Remember that you don't already need to be highly skilled at any of these. If you feel you have the potential and are motivated, put that skill on your list. So, is there a word-related skill or two that you'd like to use in your career? Science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM. The most valuable skills in these careers are advanced math, software coding, and in-depth knowledge of a scientific field, plant genomics, food chemistry, or the physics of lasers, for example. Do you have, or sense that you could, with reasonable effort, acquire good skills in one or more of those areas? Hands-on. These skills include the artistic, adapting a template website to make it uniquely attractive, for example. They also include the more functional, for example, installing or repairing an industrial robot. Some people are more skilled in small-scale work, jewelry, die-making, or iPhone repair, for example. Others do better on a grander scale, heating systems, truck repair, or furniture making, for example. How about you? Could you see a particular hands-on skill being central to your career? If so, which one? Or are you like me? When something breaks, my first instinct is to call the repair person. Entrepreneurial. Do you think you can identify unmet needs that you could meet while making a profit? You also need to know how to buy low and sell high, plus the art of persuasion to get vendors to sell cheap and buyers to pay well, all while retaining your ethics. So, should you identify with entrepreneurialism as a skill that you want to use in your career? Remember, you don't need to be self-employed to be entrepreneurial. Indeed, for-profits and nonprofits often welcome intrapreneurs, people who can identify a new profit center and drive it through to profitability. Your interests. As far as your interests go, you identify what turns you on. Combine a core interest with a core ability or skill, and you may find yourself with the Holy Grail, a career that makes you want to jump out of bed in the morning. Well, most mornings, anyway. Tip. A problem with choosing a career based on your interests is that many people's interests cluster in just a few areas. Entertainment, the environment, politics, animals, media, sports, fashion, high tech, food, psychology, or the arts. That usually makes competition for well-paying jobs in those fields quite fierce. So you have a better shot at finding good work if you could be interested in an area that flies under the radar, known by relatively few people, in other words. For example, few people salivate over a career in soybeans, plastics, or high-tech clean rooms. But if you become an expert at one of them, you might find yourself becoming interested in that. For example, at Thanksgiving, a young man was asked, "So, you graduated a few months ago. What are you doing for a career?" He replied, "I'm still not sure." The man's cousin said, "Well, I work at the Navistar plant. I probably could get you a job there." The man wanted to be able to afford to move out of his parents' house, so he agreed. His new job was to assemble tractor dashboards. He had no particular interest in dashboards, let alone tractor dashboards, but because he was bright and well-educated, he learned quickly. Soon, other workers on the factory floor came to him with questions, and he got promoted to foreman. When his cousin asked whether he liked his job, the man said, "I actually do." The point is that sometimes interest can grow with expertise, and if the field is not well known, promotion and increased income can show up sooner than if you were to pursue a more popular field. Of course, I'm not suggesting that everyone should become interested in tractor dashboards and the like. It's just wise to consider a range of options. What would you say are one or two interests that you could see as your career focus? Your values. People normally associate values with ethics. For example, most people say that they want to work ethically. But there are many other values you might want to prioritize in choosing your career. For example, some people value working with particular kinds of people. Perhaps you'd like to work with children with mental or physical disabilities, or with highly accomplished adults, or with people who share your political worldview, or who are businesslike rather than artsy, or vice versa. Many people value status. For example, even though physician assistants get to carry out most of the tasks that physicians perform, but with far less training and still earning a six-figure income, status seekers would rather choose the route of becoming an MD. Some people are money-driven. They aspired to such careers as executive, investment banker, or big-ticket salesperson because they value financial freedom and a nice lifestyle. They figure, if I've got to work, I might as well choose something that pays well. Other people feel that it's unwise to prioritize income and that it's wiser to focus on work that they're particularly good at and care about. Some people recognize that they want to work for a nonprofit or as a government employee. Others prefer to work for for-profit companies or to be self-employed. Still others are open to more than one sector. Many people prioritize work-life balance. Others find working extra hours more rewarding than what they'd otherwise be doing. Some people place a high priority on job security and predictable salary increases, so they might aim for a career in government. Other people prefer a career in which the risks and rewards may be greater, such as enterprise software sales. So, now it's your turn. Is there a value or two that you want to prioritize? Your preferences. Beyond values, you may have work-life preferences to consider as you choose a career. For example, some people prefer sedentary, predictable work, whereas others prefer not to be stuck behind a desk. Some people may want their job to require far-flung travel, for example, as an international business developer. Or that person may want only regional travel, for example, as an inspector for a luxury hotel chain. Adrenaline. Some folks thrive on it. They want careers in which risk plays a major role, either physical risk, as in the type that a search and rescue pilot experiences, or financial risk, such as the type A bond trader faces. Some people prefer to work in a particular location, for example, by the water, in an office, at home, outdoors, or in a particular small town, city, or suburb. Of course, these are but a sampling of preferences. Do you have one or more that should be central to your choice of career, or to how you tailor and accessorize it to fit you? Taking a more structured approach. The preceding sections offer an open-ended approach to identifying your abilities, skills, interests, values, and preferences. That process allows you to consider a wide range of options. It could be, however, that you'd appreciate a more structured approach. To that end, I've created a checklist of abilities, skills, interests, values, and preferences you can use. You can access them for free. Just go to dummies.com and type Careers for Dummies Extras in the search box. The DIY Under the Radar Career Finder. Some people are wise to identify a well-suited, under-the-radar niche, a career that excites them but that few others know about or care much about. The following sections describe several ways that you might find a lesser-known niche for you. Combining two interests or skills. Many people have two disparate interests or skills that can be combined into a custom career. Here are a few examples to trigger your thinking. A bookkeeper who loves art specializes in doing the books for artists. An early childhood education major loves being on the water and opens a small child care center in a lakefront cottage. A sports fan who loves making deals and was considering attending law school takes instead a job as a receptionist for a sports agent. His goal is to become the next Jerry Maguire. Show me the money. Niching in, a favorite product's supply chain. Pick a product you like. It can be anything. iPhone, beer, lingerie, basketball, solar panel, skin cream, apple pie. Now, imagine the steps that must be taken to deliver that product, such as beer, to the user. 1. Grow or source the hops, grain, mostly barley, and spices. Did you know that most beers are made with one or more spices? Orange peel, lime zest, cinnamon, cloves, and grains of paradise, a peppery, citrusy mix. 2. Ship the ingredients to the brewery. 3. Brew the beer, which involves heating, mashing, fermenting, and often cooling under refrigeration, and then carbonate, age, and bottle it, including label and bottle top. 4. Ship the beer to wholesalers or directly to large retailers' warehouses or to ships for export, and then locally to retailers, restaurants, and nightclubs. 5. Market the products everywhere, from highway billboards to Instagram to neon signs in a bar's window. 6. Make and distribute beer glasses and steins. Remember, at each of these steps, many people make a good living. But because most of these steps are not widely known, competition for jobs can be modest. For example, while competition for brewmaster jobs is undoubtedly stiff, it's probably less so for beer spice distributor. Yet, you get to live in the beer world. Even if your role isn't sexy, you probably get invited to tastings, parties, and other events. And once in that world, you may find it easier to get into a cooler part of the business. Now, consider the iPhone. What under-the-radar steps occur from the moment the iPhone 10 is merely a twinkle in Apple's eye to the moment you pull it out of the box? Here's the list. 1. Someone manufactures the iPhone's components. It's true that unless you have big-time connections in that world, it probably isn't the source of your under-the-radar career, but we gotta start somewhere. 2. Companies ship the phones from overseas to Apple's warehouses. There are long-distance shippers and local ones, called drayage, that remove product from the dock and transport it to local distributors or retailers. 3. Export agents specializing in facilitating international commerce, dealing with tariffs, credit, bills of lading, and currency exchange, for example, ensure that the phones reach their proper destinations with as little hassle as possible. 4. Ad agencies create the ads, film production companies shoot commercials and web videos, and graphic artists create billboards and web pages. 5. Friendly retail salespeople, support personnel, and tech specialists work in the stores and remotely. No, not all these jobs are offshored. Many have been brought back to the United States. 6. Tech tutors show you how to get the most benefit from your phone. 7. Technicians repair the phone you dropped into the toilet. That's what you get for texting on the pot. Many people would love to have a career related to basketball, but their thinking often stops at player and coach. There's much more. People are needed to build the arena, maintain the arena, run concessions, from food to t-shirts, recruit players, condition the athletes, supply the uniforms, basketballs, and other items, sell media rights, sell advertising in the arena, in programs, and on the website, keep the statistics, regularly apprise the media, handle fan and community relations, including in social media. Finally, here are some buried niches in the lingerie field. Someone has to design it. Is it you? Do you want to source fabric? Companies hire people to do just that. Do you want to be involved in the dyeing process? Do you want to be involved in manufacturing, shipping, selling, installing, or servicing the machines that make the lingerie? Do you want to oversee the factory? No sweatshops allowed. Regarding marketing, do you want to stage runway fashion shows or perhaps model in them? Do you want to raise money so that the company can expand? Would you enjoy exporting last year's hot designs to a developing nation where they'd be au courant? These lists only hint at the thousands of under-the-radar niches. Going grungy. Rather than focusing on products you like, you can focus on low popularity areas. I mean, no one grows up saying, I want to be a mover and shaker in the industrial acid business. Tip. Yet many people have rewarding careers in industries with grungy products. Janitorial, toxic waste, or post-disaster cleanup, for example. But competition there is lighter, so it's easier to rise to prominence and wealth than in a cool, commonly considered field. Most people would like to have important jobs at Google or Apple. Far fewer would want to be even an executive at a bathroom valve company. Yet, perhaps surprisingly, some people find greater satisfaction in less than sexy fields because, like the tractor dashboard hero mentioned earlier in this chapter, they can more easily become expert and increase their responsibilities, income level, and job satisfaction. Part 2. The Careers Catalog. In this part, learn about people careers. explore word people careers, add STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, to the people career mix. Look at hands-on people careers. Find out about entrepreneurial careers. Chapter 3. People Careers. In this chapter, helping others, connecting with people, making the sale, raising funds, exploring other people-oriented careers. Before we get into this chapter's specific careers, I want to say a word, more accurately 300 words, about the chapters in this part, the careers catalog. It offers scoops on 340 popular and under-the-radar careers and self-employment options. How were the careers selected for inclusion in the catalog? Some, like lawyer, couldn't be excluded even though training is long and expensive. And to top it off, the job market is tight and the dissatisfaction rate is high. Such careers are just too popular. Outside of the popular careers, the included ones score well overall on these factors. Many people find them enjoyable. Job prospects are good and the pay ranges from reasonable to excellent. They are offshore and automation resistant. They make the world better or at least are ethically defensible. You won't see tobacco salesperson listed. Here's how I selected the links for further information about a career. I preferred authoritative sources, but when their reporting seemed governed by undue caution, I chose a less authoritative, but I believe more helpful, source. A forum in which many people in the profession weighed in on their experience, for example. I downgraded sites to the extent they were focused more on recruiting students or members in a professional association than on providing even-handed insight into the career. I included one, two, or three resources, depending on a career's popularity, and on whether I found a second or third good resource that added new perspective. And if the first resource focuses on a career's positives, as is usually the case when the resource is a professional association's website, I looked for another resource that, for example, listed pros and cons. If I found a book highly rated on Amazon that offered a more thorough look at the career, I listed that last, because reading a book takes time, and it can't, like a website, be accessed instantly and for free. To ease browsing, the careers are divided into seven chapters. Chapter 3. People Careers, careers that heavily involve people contact. Chapter 4, Word Careers, speaking or writing-centric careers. Chapter 5, People Plus Word Careers, careers requiring both people and writing or speaking skills. Chapter 6, STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math careers. Chapter 7, STEM Plus People or Word Careers. Chapter 8, Hands-on Careers. These include artistic, mechanical, animal, transportation, and some medical careers. Chapter 9, Self-Employment Careers. Many of the careers in the previous chapters are sometimes done on a self-employed basis, but those listed in this chapter are predominantly so. Many careers don't fit neatly into one of the careers catalog's seven categories, but even if there were 20 categories, much overlap would remain while making the catalog more difficult to browse. So don't say gotcha when you find a career you think could have gone in another category. It probably could have. Warning. I reviewed well over 1,000 websites to find those worthy of inclusion. The vast majority prominently featured role models who were female, and only a tiny percent gave even moderate attention to white males. That was true in both male and female-dominated fields, such as nursing and education. Throughout this book, you'll see that I've taken great care to be inclusive. In that spirit, I ask readers reviewing those websites to realize that while, yes, special efforts are being made to attract women and minority employees, all people can still be viable in all fields. Don't let the pictures fool you. A final disclaimer. I was tempted to include the typical education requirement for each career, and indeed did so in my previous For Dummies book, Cool Careers for Dummies. But as a number of readers of that book pointed out, there are many exceptions to the usual path. So, in this book, I decided that including an educational requirement would unduly restrict your search. Most of the For More Information resources do include information on the standard education required. And now, disclaimers made, onward. When helping is the main job. Helping professions include the bloody and the not. The bloody ones are primarily medical and are profiled in Chapter 7. In this chapter, I focus on describing the blood-free options. Such professions, counseling and social work are the prime examples, as much art as science. Because these social science fields are still relatively young, practitioners must rely heavily on emotional intelligence, some would say intuition or a sixth sense, to decide what to do, what to say, and what not to say. If your past experiences suggest that you have that knack, that's a plus for your consideration of a career in the helping professions. Tip: another helpful attribute is warmth. You could know the science cold, yet your clients might blow off your recommendations or not be honest with you. Patience is also key. Few of us change quickly, so patient people do well with, well, patience. Caretaking and coaching. Helping people through rough patches or giving them the tools they need to be the best they can be very rewarding. The jobs in this section do that. Mediator. Traditionally, divorcing couples avoid trying to kill each other by letting their attorneys slug it out. That's expensive, adversarial, and often just plain yucky. An ever more popular alternative is for the couple to hire a mediator. In addition to divorce mediation, non-lawyers make a living in community mediation. Example: you're angry at your neighbor for playing loud music every night. Your neighbor is equally angry about your complaints. Loud music is my way to relax after the workday, and you are not going to deny me my rights. Remember, a good mediator needs the wisdom of Solomon, the patience of Job, and the listening skills of a suicide counselor. Not to worry. Mediation can be a rewarding career, even for mere mortals. Alas, it's a crowded profession, liberally laced with lawyers who'd rather conciliate than litigate. Check out YouTube for arbitrator and mediator jobs and mediation.com/2009/07/15/mediation-career-myth-busting-5-urban-legends-its-time-2-debunk. Mediation Career Myth Busting, 5 Urban Legends It's Time to Debunk. Neat Niche. Ombudsperson. Some organizations hire ombuds, persons who confidentially attempt to mediate conflicts among employees or between the organization and customers. Check out ombudsassociation.org/resources/frequently-asked-questions.aspx. Psychotherapists. For more information on personal coaching careers, see Chapter 9. Demand for psychotherapists is likely to remain strong because the Mental Health Parity Act requires that insurers cover mental illnesses to the same extent as physical illnesses. In addition, it's tough to cope with life's ever greater demands. Most psychotherapists deal with depression, anxiety, stress, and, because of the aging population, health psychology. Artificial intelligence, AI, makes this career's future a bit murky. In your workspan, could self-learning AI apps such as Woebot, woebot.io, become smart enough to replace therapists? Check out YouTube for A Day in the Life of a Counselor, apa.org/action/science/clinical/education-training.aspx, A Career in Clinical or Counseling Psychology, and amazon.com/what-never-learn-graduate-school/dp/0393702421. What You Never Learned in Graduate School, A Survival Guide for Therapists, by Jeffrey A. Kotler, and Richard J. Hasler. Neat Niche, sports psychologist. A golfer has trouble concentrating. A pitcher can't throw strikes under pressure. An entire team can't stand the sight of their teammates. Enter the sports psychologist, whose common tools are guided visualization, rehearsing stressful situations, and breathing exercises. They also help athletes with substance abuse problems and anger issues. That's why some sports psychologists refer to themselves as performance psychologists and sometimes are brought into traditional workplaces to help employees excel. Check out YouTube for sports psychology, apa.org/grad-psych/2012/11/sport-psychology.aspx, Hot Careers, Sports Psychology, and dummies.com/store/products/sports-psychology-4-dummies.productcd-04706766590.html? Sports Psychology for Dummies, written by Leif H. Smith and Todd M. Kays, Wiley Publishing. Neat Niche, school psychologist. In a school psychologist's typical project, Johnny is doing poorly in school. What should the school administrators and parents do to help? The school psychologist observes and tests the child, helps teachers and parent develop an individualized education plan, and then writes up the plan. School psychologists may also present workshops for students or parents on topics from bullying to sexuality, and screen students for programs for gifted students. Check out YouTube for What Does a School Psychologist Do? And NASPonline.org, National Association of School Psychologists. Neat Niche, forensic psychologist. Is the person sane enough to deserve the death penalty? Rehabilitated enough to be released into society? Competent enough to manage financial affairs without a conservator? More worthy of being the custodial parent? Was the death a disguised suicide to let the beneficiaries cash in on an insurance policy? Forensic psychologists try to get to the truth of the matter. Check out psychologytoday.com/blog/witness/201409/forensic-psychology-is-it-the-career-me. Forensic psychology, is it the career for me? Neat Niche, men's therapist. The past two decades have seen an increase in the number of therapists focused on the issues of women and people of color. Men are now starting to seek counselors specializing in men's issues. Check out counseling.org/publications/frontmatter/78086-fm.pdf, a counselor's guide to working with men. Occupational therapist. You help an accident victim relearn how to drive. You find an alternative for an arthritis patient who can no longer button a shirt. Using a combination of psychology, computers, braces, and common sense, the occupational therapist is the practical, patient soul who tries to help clients do what they used to do and want to do again. Check out YouTube for What Does an Occupational Therapist Do? aota.org/education-careers/considering-ot/career.aspx. Considering an OT career, and topoccupationaltherapyschool.com/pros-cons-occupational-therapist. Pros and cons of being an occupational therapist. Social worker. Many people and families need help. A child is abused. An adult has Alzheimer's disease. A struggling single parent with three kids is devastated to get a diagnosis of AIDS. Few jobs are more intimate and human than the social workers. This job is also often emotionally draining. The relentless conveyor belt of struggling people you counsel can take a personal toll. But despite the frustrations and low pay, most social workers who make it past the first 2 years like their job. Job security tends to be good. The job can't be offshored, and, alas, it's hard to foresee the need for social workers declining. Remember, although many social workers have government jobs, some social workers are employed by private agencies, such as the Red Cross, or are in private practice. For example, as advocates for elders who are ill and trying to obtain needed care and resources. Check out socialworker.com, socialworkers.org/careers/career-center/explore-social-work, amazon.com/days-lives-social-workers-professionals/dp/19291093 0x, Days in the Lives of Social Workers, edited by Linda May Grobman. YouTube for A Day in the Life of a Social Worker, and indeed.com/forum/job/social-worker/is-social-work-bad-idea/T467862. Is social work a bad idea? Neat Niche, Adoption and Foster Parenting Specialist. Public agencies, as well as private licensed ones, hire social workers and counselors to match prospective parents with children and to counsel them and the birth parents. In addition, private agencies may specialize in international adoptions. See wikihow.com/become-and-adoption-consultant. Nanny. Nannies play a key role in raising children during their formative years. Plus, the training is short, the task is manageable and often pleasurable, and you may get to work in a lovely home. That's an attractive combination, even if the pay is low. If you're good with kids and are reliable, it shouldn't be too tough to find a job. With the increase in single parents, and with two-parent families working full-time, even many less than wealthy people hire nannies. The key to enjoying nannyhood is to get hooked up with a kind-hearted family. Check out YouTube for A Day in the Life of a Bel Air Nanny, nanny.org, International Nanny Association, and amazon.com/supernanny-how-best-your-children/dp/14013081104. Supernanny, How to Get the Best from Your Children, by Joe Frost. Child Life Specialist. Imagine that you are told that your child has a serious illness and must suddenly face a significant medical procedure. The child life specialist's job is to help children prepare psychologically. For kids who must remain hospitalized for a while, child life specialists also help ensure that they receive an education and experience a bit of fun in their lives. Though it tends to be difficult to find a job and the pay tends to be low, the personal rewards may compensate. Check out youtube.com for Day in the Life of a Child Life Specialist, childlife.org, Association of Child Life Professionals, and answers.yahoo.com/question/index?mark QID=201106185312A T Y U W N. What are the pros and cons in becoming a child life specialist? School guidance counselor. The modern version of this job is more complicated than dealing with kids kicked out of class for chewing gum. School counselors may coordinate sex education, substance abuse programs, career counseling, anti-bullying initiatives, programs to curb gang violence, and on-site social work services. And yes, counselors still spend a lot of time telling kids that they had better shape up or else. Check out YouTube for school counselor Andrea Rose, schoolcounselor.org, American School Counselor Association, and amazon.com/elementary-middle-school-counselors-survival/dp/0470560851. The Elementary Middle School Counselor's Survival Guide by John J. Schmidt. College Student Advisor. In the past, professors advised students, especially undergraduates, but many colleges have realized that the skill set necessary to be an advisor is different from the one held by many professors. So, many colleges now hire counselors to advise undergraduates. Sometimes it's just a matter of reviewing a transcript and suggesting courses, but many students have issues that, while not requiring therapy, go well beyond simply coming up with a semester schedule. Check out YouTube for Academic Advising, nacada.ksu.edu, National Academic Advising Association, and amazon.com/academic-advising-comprehensive-virginia-gordon/dp/04703716. Academic Advising, A Comprehensive Handbook by Virginia N. Gordon, Wesley R. Habley, and Thomas J. Greitz. Organizational Developer. An organizational developer figures out how to make the organization and its work groups more effective, sometimes by conducting trainings and sometimes by restructuring. This person may also lead team building, communication, and diversity workshops. Some ODers approach those workshops with apprehension because many participants are often resistant, feel it isn't helpful, or that they can't speak honestly. There's often latent or overt hostility. Check out YouTube for Organization Development Animation and odnetwork.org, Organizational Development Network. Employee Assistance Professional. Workers show up with problems. Some are prone to violence. Some are engaged in substance abuse. Some have their finances in disarray. And some have elder care needs. Employee Assistance Professionals, EAPs, coordinate programs to help. On the prevention side, EAPs may establish wellness programs, sponsor workshops on time management or career planning, and even arrange carpools. Check out EAPASSN.org, International Employee Assistance Professionals Association, and amazon.com/employee-assistance-programs-enhancement-programming/dp/0398078394. Employee Assistance Programs, Wellness/Enhancement Programming by Michael A. Richard, William G. Eminer, and William S. Hutchinson, Jr. Bringing People Together. Many people enjoy connecting other people. These bridge builders may find their ideal career in this section. Personnel Recruiter. Recruiters find well-suited employees for employers. They don't find candidates simply by posting job ads. In fact, they sometimes don't even post any ads. Increasingly, recruiters solicit referrals from current employees and pluck smart commenters from professional forums and among LinkedIn profiles of people not looking for work. And recruiters attempt to lure top performers at competing organizations, hence the term headhunter. Recruiters may interview primarily by phone or Skype and use work samples and other assessments to rate applicants more objectively than by questions such as the old standard, "What's your greatest weakness?" Recruiters grew tired of hearing, "I work too hard." But a good recruiter still needs a feel for assessing a person's competence and fit with the job. A recruiter can work for an individual company or a nonprofit, or a recruiting agency. In a recruiting agency, you're part salesperson. You're trying to convince an organization to let you recruit employees for them. That can be challenging in an era in which it's tempting to save on the recruiter's fee and just place an ad on LinkedIn, Craigslist, or Indeed. Remember, the rate of job growth is fastest in temp agencies. Alas, that may be cost-saving to employers, but not good news for many employees who'd prefer stability and benefits. Though most external recruiters are motivated by money, they need to also be driven by the desire to be a wise matchmaker and to see good marriages. Check out YouTube for The 10 Skills a Great Recruiter Must Have, ere.net/the-top-20-reasons-why-recruiting-is-and-exciting-and-high-impact-job. The top 20 reasons why recruiting is an exciting and high-impact job. And volt.eu.com/pros-cons-recruitment.aspx. What are the pros and cons of working in the recruitment industry? Athlete agent or artist's agent. Many artists and athletes aren't entrepreneurial. Left to their own devices, they'd participate in their sports or art form, and the checks would somehow arrive in the mail. The agent's job is to make that happen for 10 to 15% of the take. Agenting can be an enjoyable career because you get to pick out and then champion the talented people you want to represent, work closely with them to ensure that they're well packaged, and help them reach as large an audience as possible and get as well paid as possible. Plus, being an agent requires no formal credentials. Most artists' agents learn as an agent's assistant or as a talent buyer in a book publishing company's acquisitions department, for example. When it comes to sports agents, the typical preparation includes a major in sports management or even a law degree, meanwhile working as an assistant in an agency. But perhaps more important for your future success are your innate abilities and a commitment to helping your client, the human being, not just negotiating deals. Check out superagent Lee Steinberg's How to Be a Great Sports Agent at forbes.com/Lee Steinberg/2012/08/15/how-2-b-a-great-sports-agent/#2a26e70a6bf3. NAPAMA.org, North American Performers Arts Managers and Agents, AARonline.org, Association of Authors Representatives, and Amazon.com/agent-tells-all-tony-martinez/dp/09761433305. An Agent Tells All by Tony Martinez. Casting director. Would you find it fun to cast a sitcom, an epic motion picture, a toilet paper commercial? Here's what you do as a casting director. You write a breakdown, a list of the needed characters, email it to agents, and wait for submissions, photos, and resumes. Then you pick people to audition. Casting director Lisa Pirioli says, casting is perfect for people who were unpopular in high school. This is their way of getting back at all the people who didn't ask them out. You may have to start as a volunteer. Check out castingsociety.com/join/getting-into-casting, getting into casting, and amazon.com/confessions-casting-director-secrets-audition/dp/006229209. Confessions of a Casting Director by Jen Rudin. Pressing the Flesh for Fun and Profit. Sales and its nonprofit analog, fundraising, are among the few potentially lucrative careers that may not require a college degree. What is required is the ability to speak, listen, and be resilient and ethical in the face of many no's, no responses, and changed minds. Here's a list. Sales representative. When you hear the word salesperson, what's the first word that comes to mind? Pushy? Although those types are around, many successful salespeople don't fit the stereotype. They and their nonprofit analog fundraisers are good listeners at least as much as good talkers. They query or intuit the prospect's practical and psychological motivators. Based on that, they ask questions likely to lead the prospect to say yes. Remember, though salespeople and fundraisers need product knowledge, of course, they must also be eager to help prospects solve their problem, even if it doesn't result in a sale. Such generosity often pays off in the long run, and the good salesperson feels okay about such giving, even when it doesn't pay off. On the other hand, Salespeople are self-starters who are motivated by money. They're not reluctant to ask for the sale and are resilient when customers decide, despite the salesperson's considerable effort, not to buy or to buy elsewhere. Many salespeople are surprised to find that they actually spend less than half their time selling. They answer technical questions, write proposals, handle problems with product or delivery, and write reports to management. However, a sales career offers flexible hours, and if you're an outside sales rep, a chance to travel. Plus, it's nice to know that your income is directly related to your performance. The more you sell, the more you make. Alas, it may be tough to know how much you're likely to sell. Even good salespeople will fail if the product, territory, or commission schedule is poor. Before accepting a job, ask one of the company's other salespeople about those matters. Remember, if you're good, a career as a sales rep is more stable than many other for-profit careers. Employers are loath to lay off the sales team because they're the link to short-term profits. A sales rep job can also be a good launch pad to promotion, because the lifeblood of businesses and nonprofits is money, and because salespeople bring in the money, organizations often promote top salespeople to management and leadership positions. Check out bls.gov/careeroutlook/2011/summer/art03.pdf, paid to persuade, and salescareer.net/.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.